guys read the Quran?
I've read a portion of it.
Right, what about you? Have you read the Quran?
She's agnostic. She never read, I think.
It's okay. Is it okay if I give you a gift?
Please, yes.
Yeah? What about you? Do you want one?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. They're from Australia, brother.
Yeah. Australia?
Australia.
Australia or Australia?
No, Australia.
Down under?
Yeah.
Okay, that's good. So you, my brother has been telling you about Islam. And you probably heard about it. Because you said you read portions of the Quran.
Yeah.
So what prompted you to read the Quran? If you don't mind me asking.
I grew up in a predominantly Muslim area, so it was just in Australia.
You ate a lot of samosas and all the nice, mashallah, all the food that comes in Ramadan.
Maybe when my teachers were, doing Ramadan, it's been chaos.
It's good, you see. Go on, Siraaj. But what I wanted to do is this lady, if you read the Quran, and I don't know if you read the Bible as well. The thing is, if you compare the two, you'll find a lot of clear distinctions between the two.
Yeah.
So between the Quran, the Torah of the Jews, and the Injil, the New Testament of the Christians, you'll see one man stands out, and that is Jesus.
Yeah. He seems pretty prominent to me in both of them.
Yeah, so in all three religions, there's a difference of how they believe in.
Yeah.
So Siraaj, I was just going to say to the to
the
sister that in Judaism, they completely reject Jesus, that?
Yeah, yeah.
As a prophet,
before,
or even as
an... Islam's after.
Yeah, so the Christians, they completely go to the other extreme.
Yeah.
They make him a god. Yeah, and the Muslims, we don't reject him, we don't make him a god.
Yeah.
We see him as what he propagated, that is, he was a messenger of God, and he was the Messiah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we believe in many things which the Christians believe, like the virgin birth, like the second coming, and all these things that needed great miracles and all. Yeah. So anyway, look, all the prophets and all the messengers, whether in the Bible or the Quran, they all propagated the worship of one God. Yeah, and never will you find them advocating a triune God, like the Father, Son, Holy Spirit of God, like the Christianity. So Islam is basically taking you back to the original belief.
Okay.
Because you see, in Judaism, you can become a Jew based on your mother or your father.
Okay.
Your tribe is based on the father.
Yeah.
Yeah. In Islam, there's no such thing.
Yeah.
There's no attachment to the race.
No.
So whether you are an Arab or a non-Arab, white or black, it doesn't matter. What did the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam say in the last khutbah, in
there's
the last sermon?
There's no superiority over Arabs over black. White
Arabs over non-Arabs?
Yeah.
And
white over Arabs, black over whites, white over Arabs.
Yeah. So there's no superiority.
Except by the piety.
There's no superiority of the Arab over the non-Arab,
okay.
or the white over the black, or the black over the white,
okay.
except by piety, like you said.
Yeah.
So whether you're a male or a female, doesn't matter what background you come from, it is your piety, which means your God consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because that's the most important thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Now, I don't know what you believe. Do you believe in God? You don't.
I'm an atheist.
You're an atheist.
She's agnostic.
Okay. So if I were to ask you, where did the universe come from?
Big Bang.
And what caused the Big Bang?
Molecules.
No, but there were no molecules, during the Big Bang.
Yeah.
I don't know if you study the Big Bang. The Big Bang, when it happened, even before that, we call the Planck time, from a singularity, then the Big Bang, and then 400 million years passed before matter existed.
Yeah.
That means before atoms and molecules, 400 million years of what you would call the dark age of the within the universe.
Yeah, yeah.
So the question still remains, what caused, because logically speaking, anything that begins to exist, we know that the universe is not eternal. Yeah, there was a point in time, the scientists, there's a consensus which says that the universe began to exist something like 13.8 billion years ago. So the question now arises, did the universe create itself, or did it come from nothing? Or was there some agency with a will that brought it into existence?
Yeah.
Which is the most plausible explanation?
Big Bang.
No, but the Big Bang wasn't there. Remember? It came. It happened at a particular time.
It came after
some time. Before the Big Bang, what caused it?
Well, do you have evidence of...
That's what I'm asking you.
I mean,
because you're the one saying Big Bang. I'm asking you what caused it.
I feel like none of us are ever going to know. It's going to be that we die and then it'll be a I told you so.
That's a big claim. That's a bold claim to say none of us will know. We are here. We exist. So something obviously brought this existence into play.
Yeah.
Because you see, everything that exists must have an explanation. Whether it is something which depends on something else for its existence, or whether it's self-existent. So the question is, you cannot say it came from nothing, because by definition, nothing, absolute nothingness, doesn't even exist. It's just a concept for us to communicate.
Just oblivion.
Yeah, so the question is, if it's not nothing, then the universe couldn't have caused itself, because it didn't even exist to begin with.
Okay.
So what is the most plausible explanation? There must be a cause, which is uncaused.
Yeah.
Yeah. Otherwise, if that cause itself, then you'll ask the question, okay, what caused it?
Okay.
Just like we ask the question about the universe. Mm-hmm. What caused the universe? So anything that begins to exist must have a cause. But we believe that this entity which caused it is not something that was caused itself. It was self-existing since eternity. And that's the only plausible explanation which is logical and rational for us to understand that it came from such an entity which always existed. It was uncaused, uncreated, had a will. Because in order to create something, obviously you need a will.
Yep.
It needs, also it has intelligence. Because if you look at the universe, you know, in fact, if you look at the most tiny snowflake to the massive solar systems and the massive galaxies, even bigger than that, all of that, there is some order. It's not all chaotic.
Yeah,
like the planets orbiting, the snowflake having a beautiful tapestry. Yes, all of this is not just something which happened by itself. We know there is intelligence behind it. For example, if I were to say that bag just popped out of existence, you wouldn't believe it, would you? Because it has a shape, it has some writing on it, and all of that obviously has a cause. Similarly, we know that the universe has this symmetry which we know has a design, and behind such a design, just like a bag, there must be a designer. There must be an intelligent designer. Because that is not just some gobbledygook, isn't it? That's some writing, I don't know what it says. Is what you say?
It's the bookshop.
The bookshop, yeah, that's a nice bookshop.
Can you ask the sister, is the Big Bang now bringing rain, night, day and night?
No.
So what's bringing that? So you said the world existed because of Big Bang.
Yeah. Yeah.
But now day, night comes, someone passes away, someone comes to the world, all this. Are you telling me still Big Bang is doing all this?
No, it's not the Big Bang.
What is doing then?
Any scientific reasons.
But what is
about
it? Is the scientific bringing rain and day, night?
Yes.
Huh? Are they upstairs? Are they in the sky now? Doing
no, she's saying there's like an explanation for it.
The solar system, the galaxy.
Yeah, but we're not like talking about the explanation of how it happens.
Mm-hmm.
We are asking about what is causing it. Okay, for example, if we are talking about the universe itself, yes, look, there was no gravity, no matter, no molecules, no energy, nothing before. In fact, there was no space and time before the universe.
Mm-hmm.
So what caused it? And this, for you to say that no one can answer that question, I think it's not an answer. That is only...
I think when we're talking, though,
that's
I'm
an appeal
like
to ignorance.
Physical evidence. That's what I'm all talking, you know, science, okay. Like physical brother, evidence.
If the uncaused
brother,
cause
I got an answer.
Outside of time and space...
Yeah.
She's coming from a different angle.
Yeah, no,
from
I'll
the
come to that point. I'll come to that point. And what I was asking is, as you said in Big Bang, yes? And you believe what scientists said, yes?
Yes.
So you said there's no evidence for us. So you said there's no God. So just because scientists said to you, Big Bang created everything. So you're telling me you believe scientists, were they there when the Big Bang was creating everything?
Yeah.
Were they there?
Wait, what do you
were
mean?
They there? Scientists,
oh,
them
no.
themselves.
No.
So where's the evidence? Where's your evidence? See?
Yeah. But I'm
see
more
now.
Likely to
see
believe
now.
Them.
See now. So you have the scientists themselves have no evidence that the world was created by Big Bang. And you telling me that there's no proof evidence that God exists, but you believe the Big Bang created, though you have no evidence. Even the scientists themselves. Do you know scientists? Do you know scientists?
No, but the scientists they say they don't know.
They don't know.
So it's not really a response. It's more like appeal to ignorance.
Yeah.
So once you have said you don't know, then it shows that you have no evidence either.
Yeah.
See what I mean?
I think that's an honest way of saying it.
No, but we are also saying it in a way where there is a response to it. I gave you the plausible explanation that there must be an entity which brought all this into existence. And that's the most plausible explanation. Because, like I said, we already exist. So we cannot say that, we don't have an answer how we can. We have to inquire about these things. And logic dictates that it cannot come from nothing. And it cannot be caused by itself. That means the universe cannot be its own cause. So what is the most plausible explanation? There must be something outside the universe which brought it into existence. Isn't it?
I mean, I don't necessarily believe that.
Okay,
but
you give me.
No,
no, you give me a rational explanation of any other possibility, and I'm willing to listen.
Would you believe if I say this phone came by itself from the ground?
No.
Like, can you believe if I say this phone was made by Big Bang now? So why would you believe back in the days the world was created by Big Bang, but this tiny phone cannot create this tiny phone now?
Yeah.
Can Big Bang create this one? No. So why would you believe the Big Bang created the world, but you don't believe this big? If I tell you now this phone was created, was made by Big Bang, you can't believe that one. But you believe this universal, beautiful world, day, night comes. Yeah, day, night comes. Yes. Are you telling me the Big Bang is doing that job now even?
No, that's not the Big Bang.
So we believe God is created, is all powerful. So he does whatever he wants. So if you believe human being can make this phone, yeah? Human being can make this phone. So why can you not believe the mighty God which created us?
Allah said, do you think there is a possibility of God's existence? Yes or no? No. You see, that is what, once you have appealed to ignorance, saying, I don't know, then for you to say there is no possibility of this happening, that means, then why would you say a definite no?
If I die,
I would rather respect her position, which is agnostic.
I fully get that, but for me, it's a, if I die and I go to heaven, then be like, I told you, you can say it, I told you so, and I'll accept
it. But that's the point.
But that would be too late.
Yeah, but I think you're on the ground.
Because
you're on the ground, and there's nothing. I want to enjoy my life.
No one's stopping you from enjoying your life. Not because you believe in God.
Okay, sister, which would you like to enjoy the life now for temporary or forever?
What I'm in the moment.
No. Would you like forever to enjoy the life?
But we don't know what forever is. We don't know what it is. We don't know who's right. There's so many religions.
Okay, let
so
me put it this way. That's actually a good question. But let me put it this way. Let's say we, one thing for certain, yes, and this is the certainty, that we all will die one day.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Whether you are an atheist, agnostic, a person who believes in God, regardless of that.
Yeah.
Yeah? Because this is a certainty. We know that one day all of us will die.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say one day we die and we all become dust.
Yes.
Yes?
Yeah.
Which is your version.
Yes.
That one day we'll perish and that's the end of it.
Yeah.
No accountability, no nothing.
No.
No questioning in the grave or anything like that. Yes? If that was the case and we all died, what am I losing? Or what are you losing? Nothing, right? Because we become dust.
Yeah.
Then whatever we believed before we were dead is irrelevant, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, now, because you see, your version, if that really did happen, then I'm not really losing anything as a believer in God.
No.
Now let's flip the coin. If there is indeed a God, and there is indeed a life after death, and there is indeed questioning in the grave, and after you die, there is a new beginning.
Yeah.
Yes? Like the brother was saying, an eternal life.
Yeah.
Yes? Then who's taking the bigger risk? So who is more intelligent? The one who takes the bigger risk or the one who minimizes the risk?
The one who makes the most of what they're doing in the moment.
No, the one who minimizes
that's
the risk.
Not an answer to his question.
The one who minimizes the risk.
You're suggesting. This is an open
forum. No, brother.
So what I'm saying, any analytical scientist, whether you believe it or not, they will minimize the risk always.
Mm-hmm.
Do you agree?
Yeah.
Because that is the intelligent solution to anything. When you have multiple risks, you look at the option which has the least risk.
Yeah.
I don't know if you do investments. Do you invest your money? You're too young, baby. Once you start investing money, you'll use this logic as well.
Yeah.
To minimize the risk in terms of your finances, see which one gives you the least loss and gives you the maximum benefit. That is called risk analysis. So you do risk analysis and you minimize it all the time. And this goes for everything. When you have a child, you're going to minimize the risk of the danger to the child. Yes? So I've seen many parents saying, baby on board, as if that makes a difference. I don't know why they do that, but that's not minimizing risk. That's just make feel they believe that this will, I don't know, makes them feel good or something. You see, that's what I'm saying. If I go by your version, then I'm maximizing the risk.
Yeah.
If I go based on the reason, by the way, this is called Newton's, what's it called? Pascal's wager. That's one. Yeah. So this is called Pascal's wager, and this is quite an interesting way to identify belief and disbelief.
Yeah.
Because if you go by belief, like I said, if your version was true, there's no risk involved at all, actually. Yes? But if the other way, then you're taking a huge risk. In fact, you're putting all your eggs in one basket.
Yeah.
And that way you are now, when you die, you have no chance to come back, you know? There's no reversal. So you don't get a second opportunity. And it's a one of, because you see our life, it was 70, 80 years today. And that's what the brother was saying, that this life, it's temporary. You know, if I was going to the US or to Australia, let's say for example, and I had a stopover, say in Singapore, and it's a stopover, it's only a few hours, you know, it's a transit.
It took me a couple of
couple of days ago.
There you go. Alhamdulillah, yes. Because I went to Australia, so I know I need to stop over there. Okay. So when you come to the UK from Australia, it's the other way around, isn't it? You're coming to the UK. Did you pack for Singapore or for the UK?
Okay.
Why is that?
I'm not unpacking my bag in Singapore.
It's because the transit is temporary. We know this.
Yeah.
It would be illogical to pack all your bag just for the few hours of transit. So you pack for the final destination. Similarly, you know, when we die one day, we will face the consequences of our actions, whether good or bad. And we will be either rewarded or punished for that. Yes? As an atheist, I know it's not something that you believe in, but I'm just asking you, just to, for a moment, think of the possibility. Because, you know, an intelligent person will look at all options and pick the one which is the most plausible.
Yeah.
And same way with the creation, we know that it's impossible for the creation to come from nothing or creating itself. So the only plausible explanation, the most intelligent being, when you are thinking about all this existence, the only one that makes sense is there must be an intelligent designer to design all of this. Yeah? And that is the only plausible explanation. For you to say no, there isn't, I think then you're appealing again to ignorance, because before the universe existed, there was no space and time either. Do you know that? Can you imagine anything that takes place without space or time? You can't even imagine it. And that's the reason the scientists will never have an answer to this. You know why? Because for them to even postulate a theory or to have an equation, they need these factors like space and time for them to perform. Because you know what is time? Time is the change. Yeah, from point A to point B, when there's a change, you say time has elapsed. Yeah, and that is what it is. But without time and space, they can never explain anything. And that's the reason they cannot explain things which are not non-material. Now, if I were to ask you, do you believe that there is a... Do you believe in consciousness? Consciousness.
Like, are we aware of our own actions? Like,
Yes. Are you conscious?
Yes.
Have you ever... Do you think the scientists have ever seen this in the lab? Why? If I were to ask you, do you have any empirical evidence for consciousness? Objective empirical evidence.
Well, isn't everything that's...
Yeah, we all believe it, including the scientists. Yeah, they believe they have consciousness.
Yeah.
But what I'm asking is for objective empirical evidence, which means it's not something that you as an individual experience, because what is consciousness? It's to be aware of your environment. Yes? Because there's a philosopher, Descartes, he said that, I think, therefore I am. Yes? So it's your understanding, your awareness of what's happening around you. Yes? So you know when somebody is in a vegetative state, they're unconscious in the hospital, that means they are not aware of what's happening. So you can slap him, you can inject him, and he won't feel anything because he's not conscious of those things. But he's not dead. He's still alive. Yes? So that's the difference between something which is immaterial, like consciousness, yet you believe in it. So the very scientists who demand evidence for everything, including yourself as a non-scientist, but you believe that only in the material existence, I showed you an example of something which your core, you know, everything of your understanding of this world depends on that faculty called your consciousness. Your faculty of reasoning, the very questions you ask and the response you give is based on your consciousness, you know? Because an unconscious person cannot question and cannot answer. So you need to be conscious in order to respond, in order to use your faculties of reasoning. But when we ask you for empirical evidence, you can't give it. You know why? Because it is something which is immaterial. And science only deals with things which are in the material world. And that's the reason I cannot say that science is a perfect tool to identify God. Because if it cannot even identify your own consciousness, which is immaterial, let alone angels in heaven and God and all that, yes? Let alone all the immaterial things. Because your own self, for which you say, I am, like Descartes said, I think, therefore I am, even for that most basic, fundamental thing of your own existence and your reality, you don't have evidence. But you believe it. You know how you believe it? By faith. You believe it by no other reason but faith. Even an atheist will have to do this. Without that, you cannot ask any questions. You cannot reason. And that's the reason, as Muslims, we believe that our world, our existence, whether the universe or outside the universe, is not just based on the material world. We believe that there is a material world and there is a unseen immaterial world, which I've demonstrated with the evidence of the consciousness, which no scientist will deny. And that's why, you know, go home and do a search on this phrase. It's called the hard problem of consciousness. The hard problem of consciousness. You know why? Because for everything else you'll find evidence, but for the most important thing in your life, in your existence, you don't have evidence, but you will believe it by faith. And that's the reason I say that all those people who reject this unseen world, you will have to deny your own self before you do that. See what I mean? So that's why you have to go and believe by hook or by crook your own self of your soul. And this is what we call soul, your consciousness. Yeah? Everyone has it. And whether you like it or not, you have to believe that. And that's why I say, you know, for anyone to say that, okay, show me the evidence for God, because I believe in science, you can't show me objective empirical evidence. You cannot show empirical evidence for your own soul, for your own consciousness, and you're asking for something that's beyond your understanding and capability. It's like me telling you, okay, take this metal detector, yeah, take a metal detector,
yeah,
and go and look for plastic. Will you find any? Why? Because you're using the wrong tool. Similarly, when you're using science as a tool to locate God and the unseen world, like your consciousness, then you're using the wrong tool.
So it's a tool that you are using then?
We call it the philosophy of science, for example.
Okay.
Yes? Which includes everything, including religion, including faith, all of this. Because these are existential questions which the philosophy of science will answer for you. Just like I took you logically and rationally using understanding of your own consciousness, using the understanding of the existence like the universe.
Yeah.
Yeah? Because I took you a logical, plausible explanation. I did not even use the term God in that explanation. You know why? I did this deliberately. Because before I jumped to that conclusion that this is God, I want you to use the faculty of reasoning, which all of us have, and then come to an understanding from a logical perspective. Yes? Because this is something for us as human beings, which we differ from the animals, because they can't reason like us. We have this special, we are a special creature unlike any other, like the animal kingdom. They might live and they grow up and they eat the food, they procreate, and then they eventually die. Do you think we are not beyond that? We are not above that as human beings? Yes, of course we are. If I were to ask you, what was the purpose in life? What would you say? I know it's a difficult question. I see that huge sigh. But this is, you know, this is an existential question which all philosophers, all the people who think about their own existence at some point asked. I'm sure you guys did as well. Because you look like intelligent people. And I'm sure whether it's in your classroom or within your own, I don't know, in your privacy at home, you must have pondered on this question. Why am I here? What is the purpose of my existence? Give me your best shot. I hope I'm not putting you on the spot. wait, let them answer.
Yeah, I am.
Yeah? What do you think is the... Oh, sorry, I might be wrong. So, don't be embarrassed. Because, look, we all have reasons to live in this life. What is the purpose you think you exist?
I sort of grapple the two ways. So I have my personal view, which is to make as much meaning as I can, whatever that means. And then more broadly, what's the meaning for human existence? I don't know.
Yeah, good, go on.
How do we know? And that's the thing.
No, give me your personal and the broader existence. Give me both.
Well, as humans, we always want to know why, and we always want to understand and have an explanation of everything, but I just haven't been able to find it.
Okay, so you haven't actually found a response to that, profound question.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is... It's a small question.
Yeah.
It's a very small one line, you know?
Yeah.
But the answer, it baffles everyone.
Yeah.
Because first and foremost, to find an answer itself, you know, look, your bag has a purpose. Yeah? Your clothes have a purpose. Why do you think you don't have a purpose? If such insignificant things have a purpose, why do you think you don't have a purpose?
Why not?
Because if you're just like animals, you know,
yeah,
who are born, eat, drink, procreate, they don't even get married, do they? And they die eventually. I'm sure we, with that extra feature we have called reasoning and rationality, we must have a higher purpose. I'm pretty sure. As a human being, I can sense this.
Yeah. Can I pose the same question to you?
Yeah, I'll answer, of course. Because my answer comes from the Quran. So for me, it's easy. I can actually just copy the answer from it. But I didn't just come to that answer just like that, obviously.
Yeah.
Before accepting the Quran and my religion and my God, obviously I had to go through the same exercise you guys went through.
Mm-hmm.
I had to question everything. But then I come to a conclusion that all this, it's impossible for it all to come into existence from nothing, just like magic. Yeah, it's something which I cannot, as a human being, with my rationality, accept that it just popped out of existence from nowhere. Because just like the brother asked you about the phone, you know, or I asked you about the bag.
Mm-hmm.
If such insignificant things, you know, your eye itself is the best camera than any camera in existence today. I don't know how many thousands of megapixels your eyes are, which they are still, they cannot even grasp a fraction of that. Okay? So one eye, if I were to ask you, okay, I'm going to give you 20 million, give me one eye of yours. What are you going to say?
Okay.
Okay? You sure? How about two eyes?
No. 20 million.
20 million, 40 million, and you live blind all your life?
A couple hundred bucks.
You sure?
I'm happy.
You know, when I come with the scissors or the knife, you change your mind, trust me. Okay, so it's very easy to make this, but when you to commit to it, it's difficult. And we all know the value of every single organ of ours. Yes? Every major organ of yours, yes? You know it is something, even the appendix.
No appendix, actually.
Even the appendix. You know, many people say these vestigial organs have no reason to exist. They are irrelevant. But the list of vestigial organs is getting shorter. Because as the days go by, they find out the reason. The appendix has got a lot to do with the stress. Go and look it up. So the old studies, you know, maybe in the 90s and all, is irrelevant. Remember they talked about the junk DNA? The junk DNA. So our DNA, only a fraction of it is used. Yeah, the color of your eyes, the skin tone, the color of your hair, all this come from the parents and the grandparents and so on. Yes? But then they said that only a small percentage of your DNA is relevant to that hereditary traits from your ancestors. And the rest is junk. That is what they told us. As the days goes by, this junk DNA becomes more and more relevant. They find out the purpose of a lot of this DNA and its reasoning. That just shows us, isn't it? Take the DNA. It's if you look at the structure of it, it's like somebody has programmed it. Someone intelligent has programmed it. There's no way in a million years you'll say that it's going to be a perfect layout of the chromosomes and the DNA. The way it is, it's impossible that it came about by chance.
Yeah. Look at different shaped noses all around the world, and it's for different environments.
No, it's based on your DNA. Your environment can change. For example, if you go to a hotter country, your skin tone might change. It adapts.
You need more melanin.
Yeah. Why does it adapt? The melanin and all? Because there are switches inside your own system, in your physiology, which switch on and off. You know, sometimes you find the fish in two different ponds, they're exactly similar, but over years they've changed because of the environment. It's the same fish, but it has changed the physiology. So when you look at it afterwards, they look completely different fishes. So what the scientists realize is that within the DNA, there are certain switches which switch on and off. So it was already programmed in you for the switches to switch on at, depending on the circumstances and the environment. Isn't that beautiful? The DNA code is so beautiful that it is already programmed in you that these changes can take place and you can adapt to your environment for yourself to adapt for, obviously, to make sure that you exist now in an environment which is might be not easy for you before those changes happen, but now it becomes easier. So what I'm saying is that all these things are programmed in you, and there's no way anyone who has studied the DNA will say that this is just out of, by chance, random. There's no such thing. Anyone who has it. You know, there's a saying that if you know science, you become an atheist. But if you know the in-depth, if you know science in-depth, then you become a believer in it.
You know, the saying is, a sip from the glass of the natural sciences might make you an atheist, but at the bottom of the glass, God awaits.
Yeah.
So it's like the more...
The more you study, the more you realize that this is no way, this is by chance.
One thing, you know, Quran talks about science. Have you ever read? Without Quran, science wouldn't exist. Many things now, they found out from the Quran. So now you tell me, we believe Quran is the word of Allah, the word of God. and scientists now approved the Quran, which Quran talks about science.
Okay.
So no, not just
that you also indicates no man. That indicates the existence of God.
Yeah.
Because we believe the words of Allah is the Quran.
You
could
look
is the
into
words
the man
of Allah.
Who came up with falsification, or I mean, there's a European man that claimed it, but then he also gave credit backwards to the Muslim scholar and theologian who came up with it. He came up with falsification. So that's
I'll
the
just
scientific
give you one
method.
Verse. You
and
tell
where
me
it
what
came
do you think
from,
about that verse?
Where, yes, Ibn Haytham.
Do you know the
so
verse,
where it came from
18.
Was the Quran actually has a falsification test.
Okay.
And this falsification,
no,
like the
18.
Idea of falsificationism yeah. was so you know, deductively and just rationally so
chapter
useful. He then started applying it in a scientific endeavors as a scientific method. Because by the way, scientific method isn't something that's standard. It's changed over time. So far,
anyway,
that's where we get falsification.
Let's not go too much into science. The reason for that is because the Quran, by itself, it says that it's a book of science,
yeah,
science, not science. So there might be things in there which the scientists might have discovered. But the important thing is that we have to realize that it is a book of science. Okay. So anyway, let's not go too bogged down into that because we, as like I said, rationally, logically, when you start thinking, all of this falls into place.
Brother Hashim,
yeah?
I just want you to tell
yeah,
them
read it,
this
read it.
Science.
Go on, read it.
This verse is in the Quran, chapter 23, verse 14. It was about science, and you can search up scientists talk
read
about
it,
this.
Yeah, just read.
So
read
it
read.
Says it's about the creation of mankind, the process.
Mm-hmm.
So it says here, then we made the seed a clot. Then we made the clot a lump of flesh. Then we made in the lump of flesh bones. Then we clothed the bones with flesh. Then we caused it to grow into another creation.
Oh, yes, yes, thank you. I what's it called?
You see that? The clot and all that, the procedure, the way the flesh, the bones, all that. It's in the Quran. So where did they get from?
One first of all,
even the three darkness, scientists talk about that in the womb, in the darkness of the belly, and the water, all that is in the Quran. Chapter 30, it says in chapter 39.
You can search up non-Muslim embryologists breaking it down.
You can search up. So now you tell me the Quran scientists now approve themselves. They approve that the existence of Allah. Do you know why? Because the Quran is the words of Allah. If it's the word of Allah and they approve in Quran and they got the science from the Quran, so Prophet Muhammad never knew about science. He was an illiterate. He never knew how to write. He never knew how to read.
What's
he never knew about
the
science.
Remarkable thing
so
is
now,
that.
So now you
like
tell me, how can you deny? So now you believe what science say, yes? And they quoted from the Quran. Why can you not believe the existence of Allah, of God? Since you believe science, since you believe whatever science say, and they quoted from the Quran, so therefore you should believe the Quran. Because you said Big Bang, and who told you science? Scientists. Were they there? No. Do you have any evidence? No. So why? Something that you don't even have, imagine you believe. Yeah, you can ask. You believe, even now you believe of Big Bang, relies on without an evidence. So Big Bang is gone. And plus, additionally, everything science say, they disagree. Am I right, Brother Hashim? Brother Hashim? Brother Hashim? Wait, brother. Brother Hashim, do you agree with me, all scientists, in some cases, they disagree upon matters? See?
Oh, yeah, well, that's
so,
it.
So,
some
that,
scientists
yeah,
agree
yeah.
With that,
so, see now. So, even then, whatever they say is not accurate.
I think,
you don't believe.
You got a question, you said?
You have a question?
Sorry, I did not answer the question I asked you earlier about the about our purpose. So,
yeah.
In the Quran, Allah says the purpose that every human of worship of God. What does that actually mean? Sometimes worship doesn't mean pray all day and that's it. No. Worship means to be obedient to God. Yes? So the obedience to God means, again, everything that He has forbidden us to do, we abstain from that, and everything He has recommended for us to do, we do that. Yes? Now, what does that mean? For example, let's say you as an agnostic or an atheist were my neighbor. My religion teaches me. Yeah, inshallah. My religion teaches me that I have to respect my neighbors regardless of the faith or lack of faith for that. And this is something that we have to respect as Muslims. You have to respect our neighbors. Doesn't matter what background they are from. Belief or disbelief doesn't matter. So I would not be a Muslim. In fact, I would be a bad Muslim if I
One advice, I'm just going.
Yeah,
and inshallah, if you go and read the Quran, if you just read one verse and you don't read the rest of the Quran, you will not understand the Quran.
Yep.
So let's say you can come to cross or like a verse that says about, talks about during the battle. So do not assume it says about killing the non-Muslims. Some verses, it tells us like chapter 60, verse 8, Allah tells us, do not kill, do not, you have to give peaceful the non-Muslims if they incline peace. So do you understand that? So do, if you
take
read
it
the
in
verses,
context, basically.
I'm just saying the context.
So what I was saying is that the purpose of your life is basically obedience. What does obedience mean? You know, if you got a phone and you know who the manufacturer is, whenever you buy a phone, they give you a user guide. Any equipment that is complex, they give you a user guide. In fact, I think today even for if you buy like a scissor or something, they give you some sort of written. It just shows you professionality, that they care for your safety and security. So you would, if you have a Samsung phone, you prefer that you go by what the manufacturer tells you rather than what some Tom, Dick and Harry tells you about the phone, because you would trust them more. Similarly, we believe that the Creator has created us and He knows what is best for us as individuals and as a community as well. Yes. So I'll give you just one example. Take the example of alcohol. Yeah. Today in every society, whether it's in the West and even the East, unfortunately, alcohol has become quite normal. Many people say it's good to have a glass of wine, to drink socially, not to get drunk, that is bad, obviously. But then the government knows that even a small quantity of alcohol is bad for you. Mm-hmm. You know, there was a huge study done by scientists who are experts in this field, and the result was published in The Lancet. The Lancet is one of the most respected medical journals. And they say that no amount of alcohol is safe. These were their words, not my words. No amount of alcohol is safe. You know why? Because they had done like a 30-year study over thousands of people. Yes, not just an overnight thing, a proper scientific study. And this was published in a peer-reviewed journal, in the medical journal that's highly respected called The Lancet. And this is their verdict, not ours as Muslims. Now, what is every, after hearing this, what do most people who say they believe in science, they did? Did they actually go by the scientific result? No. They went by their own whims and desires. Because whatever they feel good, they say that is right. So even that science which they have firm faith in, they would reject it. Why? Because they'd say that I feel this is right. And the government, what does it do? It does the same thing. Because the government, it doesn't care about your health and safety. It cares about the fact that you, it wants to get the most benefit. Because, you know, there's a lot of money in alcohol industries. Yes, there's advertising. If you look at most of the football, when I say football, I don't mean the American football, the proper football, or the soccer, as the Americans would call it. All these teams, they advertise Carlsberg and all these different alcoholic drinks, these companies. And these companies, they pay them huge amounts of money to advertise this on the t-shirts. And also in the stadium, many of the stadiums are fully funded by them. Yes? And this government, they also get a lot of tax money from, because a lot of tax is imposed on them. Yeah, every year when the budget comes out, most of these guys who are addicted to smoking and drinking, the first thing they do, the budget is out. Has the price gone up? Yes, it's gone up by a few pennies again. Yes, does it make a difference to them? No. Because how the government does it? It does it a few pennies every year. Yes, so in a few years, it's like 10 pounds more per packet of cigarette. Yes, per pint of drink. They don't notice this, but it eventually adds up. And in a year, they spend like thousands of pounds on these drinks, which doesn't benefit them, but harms them. Yes? What does Allah say in the Quran? He says, you know, when alcohol was forbidden, Allah did not forbid it overnight. By the wisdom of Allah, by the wisdom of the Creator, He said initially that there's some benefit in it, but the harm outweighs the benefit. So that was number one. So it is like indicating to the people who are intelligent that, you know, the harm is greater than the benefit. And everyone knows this today. But do they still smoke and drink? Yes, they do. Okay, those people who are addicted to it, they can't.
So is that with also like weed, stuff like that as well? Is that also?
Yeah,
absolutely. Anything so that harms your body. Yeah. Yes, the word that's used in the Quran is it's not just alcohol or something like that.
It's all encompassing. Anything that changes, alters your mental state
okay, so beyond, like your cognition. Panadol,
yeah, no. Yes.
It includes drugs. It includes everything.
We're talking about recreational drugs of all sorts. Because if you really think about it, alcohol is a drug. Yeah. It's just marketed better.
Yeah. And then the second phase, what does God say? It says, do not approach the praise while you're drunk. So again, now he's trying to tell them that you can't approach prayer. And prayers, the Muslims pray 5 times a day. So for them to abstain from it, it becomes a challenge again. Okay? And the third time, when the revelation came, it was like, now it's forbidden. So it came in stages. You know the wisdom behind this? If you look at any rehab clinics, they don't go cold turkey for the people who are going through the rehab. So if they go cold turkey, it impacts them badly. So it's counterproductive, actually. So they wean you off gradually, yes? So say, for example, if you, drink how many smoke, a whole packet one day, they take away one cigarette from that and they say, maybe you can smoke. Or maybe drug addicts or alcohol or whatever it is. So they wean you off gradually until you stop drinking altogether or you stop the drugs altogether. And this is the wisdom behind it. And that's why Allah didn't do it overnight. He could have if he wanted to, yeah. So this is one prohibition in the Quran. Like this, other things are prohibited. Like adultery, fornication, gambling, killing, obviously, murder, all these things. So if you look at everything that Allah has prohibited in the Quran, you will never disagree with any of them. All the prohibitions are there for a reason, yes? And alcohol is not just something that you harm yourself as an individual. Someone who is drunk can knock off someone who never drinks in their life, yes? And this is, again, not only for themselves. Maybe their family are sitting in the car with them who don't drink or who did not drink that day. And they kill that family, unfortunately. And maybe a family walking on the footpath because they lost control of the car, they knocked off as well. Yes? You know, today, if you go to any medical service, any emergency service, doesn't matter if it's Australia or the UK, you'll find every weekend there's huge cases of people who are drunk. And these people are intelligent people. During the day, they might have a respectful job, maybe as a teacher, maybe even as a nurse. Yeah? So they might be in the medical field or a teaching field where they know they are fully aware of the consequences. But because it becomes a social thing, they, because of the peer pressure, they start drinking and so on. But what does the Quran say? Again, it's about obedience to God. And this is the purpose of life. That if we are obedient to our Creator, then our life as an individual, as a society, will be much better. I've seen people who were celebrities, when they started taking on gambling, they destroyed themselves, destroyed their family, lost all the money that they had earned during their celebrity life. Yes? And they became in such a state that they were literally begging for money. They started lying to their friends to borrow money from them. They were indebted, you know? And speaking of debt, there's another thing that Islam prohibits, is interest rates. You know, most
interest.
So the banks, they charge you a lot of interest. You know why it's prohibited? Because most of the people who need to borrow money are in need of money. Yes, except for those millionaires who already have millions. They want to borrow more money because they know that this is the way they can save taxes. Yes, but again, the harm always falls on the people who borrow money and who cannot pay it back. Yes, and the rich become richer, and the poor become poorer, become more indebted, and they destroy their lives.
You could look at how the International Monetary Fund has the whole continent of Africa as like financially enslaved because African countries are so in debt to European countries and North America that they cannot even make the interest payments on their debt. So that's kind of the whole point. Like, it's a financial enslavement tool that puts the needy under, a position they can't get out of, basically. Yes, precisely. And that's why, actually, in return, they get to exploit the natural resources of Africa as a ways of, you can't pay us our interest, so we're going to take your natural resources. So that's, the wisdom behind why
it's...
Yeah, exactly.
And this, look, it's just snowballs from there, you know? And that is another thing which Allah has prohibited. Yeah? Because for us, if we borrow capital from someone, we expect to receive the same capital. Yes? And this is, you know, the reason many young people today cannot afford houses is because of the same reason. They put up the interest rate so high that by the time they finish paying for the house, which might have cost 100,000, will end up costing double that money. And young people today, they just have to borrow more money because they have to rent and they have to borrow money for that as well because the wages are not enough for them. So it becomes a huge burden on the society. And this, again, like I said, is not just for the individual, but it affects the whole society. And Islam again brings a solution to this. What is the solution? Don't demand interest. Pay the capital that they have offered you, and this way it helps the people as well. You know, today, even in a non-Muslim community, you know who spend the most money for charity? It is the Muslims. You know, we just passed the month of Ramadan. You guys heard of Ramadan? Okay, Ramadan is when the Muslims fast. But they don't just fast in the month. They actually start doing a lot of good things, including giving charity, because it's again an obligation for people who earn money, who have money, to give 2.5% of their savings. 2.5%, yeah. So for every $100, yeah. I don't know, Australian dollars, I think, yeah. You have, you give $2.5,
yeah.
Yes? But if you have over 1,000, you give accordingly 2.5% of that. And imagine this, it will wipe out poverty in the world. If this were done in an organized fashion, which Islam actually pays great emphasis on. So every year, you know, you must have heard many of these millionaires and billionaires giving a lot of money in charity.
Tax write-offs.
Philanthropic. Yes. Exactly. That is what it is for. Because they know that they giving charity is something that is tax deductible.
Yep.
And that's the reason they give. But for us, we give it because our religion requires it. Because God told us to. And the bigger picture of that is so that poverty is eliminated. How can we live and we fast? The whole purpose of fasting in the month of Ramadan is obviously for taqwa, the closeness to Allah. But the real reason is, like, for example, it makes us realize that there are other people who don't get 3 times meal, who don't get a 1-time meal during the day. And how can we sleep on a full belly when they are going hungry? You know? So charity is a huge portion within Islam. Some of the earliest hospitals built, long before the Europeans built them, were in Muslim countries. Some of these universities, which to this day, you know, are in existence, were actually built by women. Yes.
The oldest university still running today is in Morocco. It was built by a Muslim woman. Yeah. Al-Qayrawaniyun. Or Al-Qayrawan, I think. Yeah. But yeah. It's made by Fatima Al-Fahri. She's the scholar who started the university.
Islam, many times you see in the newspapers or media that the Muslim women are downtrodden. They are the ones who are not educated and all this. But you know, the Prophet's wife, she was one of the most educated in terms of the faith, and many of the companions used to come to her. She was a scholar. And this has always been from the time of the Prophet, that the women were always encouraged to seek knowledge. And this is huge. It's always been in the case of the Muslims. Again, you must have heard other things like, oh, terrorism and all that. You know, in the Quran, the only time when the fighting was involved was when your life was something which was threatened. It was in the context of war. You don't just stand there and let yourself be slapped all around. You have to fight for your rights. And again, Islam not only goes, it goes beyond that as well. So even though you might be safe, and if you see some other country being oppressed by another country, which is the oppressor, then you have to help them. Just like in Europe when Hitler was oppressing a lot of people, the Europeans got together and they fought them. It wasn't turn the other cheek. They literally fought them with weapons. Yeah. But then today, unfortunately, what's happened, if you see in the Middle East, most of the wars that happen is because of the greed of the Western countries. Why was the war in Iraq? Do you guys remember?
Yeah.
I don't think you guys are that young.
Yeah,
but you must have studied about it. Yeah. They were looking for weapons of mass destruction.
Which didn't exist, yeah.
But they still went to war, even though the United Nations told them.
Oh, yeah.
Just a few more minutes and we'll wrap up. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks for your guys.
For the mistake that they went.
The important thing is, even after they found out there's no weapons of mass destruction or all those dodgy dossiers that they came up with, they were all false. Nearly 1 million people died there. Yeah? Million children. Because of hunger.
5,000 children were actually dying because of not getting the medicine. Medicine was not coming into.
That was the big thing. There was a siege on medicine.
And when they were asked that, is this something that justifies? And there was, what was the name of the baby? He said, it is justified to kill children. So you see, the very morals that they went there with, to save the women from oppression, to save the people from oppression, from the tyrant called Saddam Hussein, they ended up doing 10 times worse than what Saddam was doing in that very country. And who brought them to justice? Nobody. So yeah, I mean, look, Islam is all about justice, about safeguarding the oppressed people, about charity, about helping the needy and the poor, and then bringing them all, like I said, to live in harmony. And no one, look, if anybody imposes Islam, the religion, on you, then they're not real Muslims. Because religion is something which you have to accept from your heart. It cannot be imposed on you. If it is imposed, you're fearing the person and not the creator. So everything that I said, like I said, everything that's been forbidden is there for a reason. And everything that's been implemented for you as a recommendation, like to help the needy, to help the oppressed, all these things are good for you and the society at large. Islam has been maligned a lot in the media, but look today, which is the fastest growing religion? You look at any census, and the answer will always be Islam. So even with all the negativity against the Muslim women, it is the women who accept Islam the most. Yes, from the Western, from even the Western countries.
It's funny because they hear a lot about women's rights issues with Islam, so they end up, that piques their interest, so they end up looking into Islam for that specific reason. And then they end up finding that oftentimes that Islam provides them something that Western society does not. More rights or more, what's it called, value that Western society does not. And that's how it ends up. So it actually works in the opposite way that the media does.
So, yeah, I know you guys have to go, so just one final thing. What I'm saying, look, I know you both are intelligent and the people have been listening as well, mashallah. All I'm saying is that think of this life more seriously. It is fun and enjoyment, obviously, and there's a limit to everything. But then think of that example I gave you about the transit and the final destination. Prepare for the final destination. Because like I said, one certainty is that we will all die one day. Yes, so think of that and then approach your life accordingly. I know you guys are still young, so am I, alhamdulillah, you know?
But
so,
you never know, plenty of people cross the road and get hit by cars at different ages.
We don't know when our last breath will be.
Yeah.
So, you know,
morbid but true.
Keep seeking for the truth. Have your intention pure, that I want to seek the truth and ask if there is a creator out there, if there's someone who's looking after me, I implore you to guide me in the right direction. And do that on a daily basis. And, you know, God willing, you guys will seek the truth. And inshallah, with God willing, you'll get hidayah, which is guidance from Allah. So thank you for your time, guys. I really appreciate your time.
Nice talking to you guys.
Okay. By the way, do you need a Quran or you got one?
I don't have one. Yeah, I'll
go. Okay, let's,
let's get her a Quran.
Let's give them a
Quran. So I made a video.
But Hashim, you have a Quran for her?
Absolutely.
You have a Quran?
No.
No. No, we need another one. Bro.
He's saying that Allah is God.
Can we get a Quran? Where's the Quran? I need a Quran.
One second. Yeah. We're not here to mock you, or to embarrass you, or to put you on the spot. No, because I don't know if you, this is the first time you guys come here.
What's up?
This place,
ask him.
And this is where you can ask any question, and you can talk about any topic. So I think there used to be a lot of politicians like Karl Marx, I think even Lenin, and all, they all came here. So these guys, they used to come here and they used to talk because it represents freedom of speech and expression. And this is a unique place. I don't think you'll find such a place even in a Muslim country or in any other non-Muslim country except for England. They try to have such a place in many places. I'm pretty sure they tried it in Australia as well. But it hasn't worked anywhere except here. The reason is I think they have been given special jurisdiction from the parliament for the safeguard of this place. So when there's any trouble, the police come in minutes.
Yeah, I see
that. You can imagine, you know, sometimes the tempers just fly.
Yeah.
We're just waiting for the Quran for this.
Did you send, I tried to find
Oh, I'll tell you what, are you guys going through the gate? The main gate?
Yeah, I think we're leaving. Yeah. I can read that one.
No, if you go through the main gate, just outside the gate, there's a guy standing with Quran. Just pick a copy from him. Okay?
Yeah. Let me go see if I can get them. The main gate, the one.
Care, guys. Yeah. Follow the God of Jesus Christ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.